Okay. Hello, everyone. Welcome to LAMIF++ seminar. Today, I will talk about two-dimensional lattices and a continuously parametrized map on the space of isometric classes of these lattices. This talk is based on the joint paper with Matt Bright and Andy Cooper from the Materials Innovation Factory in Liverpool. So I quickly remind key definitions. So a lattice is defined by a basis, but the same lattice can be defined by infinitely many different bases. And also we could shift our lattice consisting of black dots here and rotate it, and also choose a different unit cell. And these four pictures, when they look rather differently, however, they represent equivalent lattices, equivalent up to rigid motion, for example. And we consider this equivalence relation because it's motivated by rigidity of crystals. So more exactly, an isometry is a map that preserves all interpoint distances. This isometry is a composition of rotations, translations, and reflections, for example, in the plane and three-dimensional space. A rigid motion does not include reflections. It is sometimes called an orientation preserving isometry. And it means that if you take a linear basis and put these two vectors into two vectors in the plane into a matrix, then our orientation preserving isometry should keep the sign of the resulting determinant. In addition to these two equivalence relations, there is also a similarity between lattices. So a similarity map is a composition of an isometry, which could have an extra restriction on orientation, but also uniform scaling, when we simply make all vectors large by a constant factor S. And today we will consider actually all four equivalence relations. So usual isometries, rigid motion, similarity preserving orientation, and general similarity without preserving orientation. So each of these four equivalence relations, they define its own space of equivalence classes. So the simplest one is lattice isometry space. Well, it's simplest, but it is still huge and complicated. So it consists of infinitely many isometric classes of lattices. Infinitely many because every small perturbation of a lattice basis will produce a slightly different lattice, so not isometric to the original one. And we would like to understand these spaces to map them. So more exactly, we would like to solve the following problem. We are going to construct a complete isometry invariant that maps our lattice isometry space to a much simpler space. So in this case, it will be triples of numbers, real numbers. So very simple. So that map should be an invariant. So it means that for isometric lattices, our invariant should take the same value. The second condition, completeness, is much harder, and it's converse to the previous one. If the invariant takes the same value, then lattices should be isometric. Sometimes it's also called injectivity. Then, so why are we mapping this lattice isometry space to something else? Because on a simpler space, it's usually easier to define a distance or a metric between these invariants. So this invariant I should allow us to define a metric on lattices satisfying the standard metric axioms. And the most important of them is the first one, saying that the distance is zero if and only if these lattices are isometric. So that metric makes sense for any equivalence relation, so including orientation preserving isometries, etc. So for any equivalence, we could consider the corresponding metric problem. Then there are three more conditions, which are relatively new because previous approaches to invariants of lattices or more general crystals or to metrics, they didn't consider, for example, continuity. So we would like to make this distance continuous in the sense that if you perturb a basis of a lattice a little bit, then the distance that we define between lattices is also changing a little bit. So it will be small for a very close basis in a different suitable metric. So you will see exact definitions a bit later. Yes, we would like to compute our distance very quickly. And we will start simply from suitable basis, from reduced basis. It's a separate problem how to find a good reduced basis for lattice. But for metric computations, we will assume that a basis is already good enough. And the final condition that didn't appear in most of my previous talks is inverse design or reconstructability. So we'd like to reconstruct a lattice from this invariant. So the invariant should be simple enough to allow an explicit reconstruction so that we can take a new value in this simple space S and get a lattice as a result. So let me highlight that the metric problem, which is a sub-problem here, actually solves also the equivalence problem. So the metric problem is generally harder. If you have a distance, then checking the zero value of this distance gives us a conclusion whether lattices are isometric or not. Okay, so now indeed the technical details. If you have any questions, feel free to ask. So we started from the paper by Conway and Sloan, which was published almost 30 years ago. So this paper unfortunately contained a few typos which prevented us from understanding it for a long time. I think we have tried to read it for 3 years, but now finally we have understood everything and continued what we have started. What we have started is to consider superbases and so-called conorms. So a superbase was actually considered earlier, even by Delaunay or other people. So if you have a basis V1, V2, we add one more vector in the two-dimensional space, V0, which is minus V1, minus V2, so that the sum of these three vectors is exactly zero. For example, let's start from a simple example, say rectangular lattice in the second picture. Then V1, V2 is the original basis, and this red vector is minus V0, the sum is zero, right? So this is a rectangular lattice, is rather simple, but a non-rectangular lattice, more generic in the two-dimensional plane, has the following non-rectangular Voronoi domain. So let me formally define it. So the Voronoi domain of the origin, so we choose one point as the origin, and the Voronoi domain is the natural neighborhood of that origin, consisting of all points P that are closer in the Euclidean distance to the origin, non-strictly, than to any other points of our lattice. So for a generic lattice, this Voronoi domain in two dimensions is a centrally symmetric hexagon. So it looks like that. And here on this picture, you see a couple of superbases. So V1, V2, minus V0, and the opposite or symmetric one, minus V1, minus V2, and V1 plus V2. Any questions so far on superbases? Okay, right. Then we consider not an arbitrary superbase, we consider a superbase which is obtuse. So obtuse means that we give an extra restriction that all pairwise angles between the vectors are not acute, 90 degrees or more. And then and this is a restriction on a superbase. As a result, we'll have a smaller number of potential superbases. So what is important that in dimensions 2 and 3, any lattice has an obtuse superbase. So any basis could be reduced to this superbase form. And when we have such an obtuse superbase, then we could consider the Selin parameters, which are simply scalar products, or for us, it's more convenient to consider negative scale Selin parameters, negative scalar products, which were called conorms by Conway and Sloan. So these conorms are not negative. Also, they defined Voronoi norms. Voronoi norms means simply Voronoi norm. So these are squared lengths of these basis vectors, which are simply Voronoi vectors defined by Voronoi faces of Voronoi domain. So these are formulae which connect Voronoi vectors, so more exactly Voronoi norms with conorms. So we have three numbers, three scalar products of a superbase called conorms and three squared lengths. And of course, we can easily express these conorms in terms of Voronoi norms. So these three numbers are equivalent. So they contain the same information. That's why it's convenient to look at them as dual objects. So more exactly, we put the Voronoi norms into this triangular cycle, so at vertices of this triangle, and call it Voronoi form. So it's a Voronoi form of a superbase. And similarly, we define the coform, so a triangular cycle with marked the vertices marked by conorms. So three non-negative numbers on the left. And this picture is dual or equivalent to the picture with three numbers in the second picture. So an example, so a simple example, hexagonal lattice. So it's very symmetric. We have angles 120 degrees between vectors of equal length. If length is A, then when squared lengths are A squared, so all equal in the Voronoi form. And in the dual coform, we have also equal scalar products, negative scalar products, A squared over two. For a square lattice, everything is similar. So this zero conorm is simply the scalar product of two orthogonal vectors, and two others are equal. So that's how we can easily compute it for a given superbase. So let me repeat what Voronoi form can be computed from coform and vice versa. So we will, for a moment, forget about Voronoi form and we will work with coform and we'll actually convert it into even more convenient object. So first, what I would like to highlight that here is we fix a basis. So formally they depend on a basis and we would like to remove this dependence and later produce an isometry invariant of a lattice independent of a basis. But so far what we could notice, if you permute, if you consider an isometry, so mapping one superbase into another superbase, then we have a corresponding mapping between coforms. So if V1, V2 goes to another pair of vectors, then the scalar product maps accordingly to the equal value. And if you permute vectors within a superbase, so say 1, 2 are permuted, then we have a corresponding permutation on coforms. So this is only the first step. Any questions so far? Okay. Then we introduce a more convenient object ordered, we call it root form, which is an ordered triple of numbers. So since conorms are not negative, it's actually very natural to take square roots of these numbers because in this case, the units of root products will be the same units as coordinates in a given basis. So if, for example, we take a lattice where coordinates are measured in angstroms, then these root products will be also measure it in the same angstroms. Okay, so after we take the root products, we write them in the following order. So we write them from in increasing order from smallest to largest value. And we call the resulting ordered triple the root form. So at the moment, it still depends on the basis, more exactly even on an ordered basis B. And our aim is to show that this root form is a complete isometry invariant. In particular, it is independent of a basis. So for example, what happens if we reorder vectors of a basis? So when we reorder vectors, we reorder conorms, but root products are ordered naturally in increasing order. That's why the root form does not change under this reordering. So at least we remove dependence on ordering of vectors quickly in this step. Then, the next problem is that we might have different superbases for the same lattice. So you have already seen these examples. For example, a rectangular lattice has, here in this picture, four different superbases. So when I say different, they're actually isometric. This is a lucky fact in two dimensions. In three dimensions, it will be a bit harder. But what can we say? So a generic lattice in two dimensions has a hexagonal Voronoi domain, centrally symmetric, and it has only two obtuse superbases up to isometry. So of course we consider everything up to rotation. So we have V1, V2, minus V1, minus V2, and the centrally symmetric superbase. If you have a rectangular unit cell or a rectangular Voronoi domain, then all four different superbases here are drawn explicitly, and they're related, again, either by the central symmetry, or we also need reflection. So that's why we need to be a bit careful with reflections. That's why the oriented case here is more complicated than even originally expected. Okay, so that's why it's important to consider to differentiate between achiral and chiral lattices. So this concept chirality, it makes sense for many general objects, say for molecules in a three-dimensional space. Actually, the last Nobel Prize was given for synthesizing chiral molecules, which are not mirror symmetric. So a lattice is called chiral if this lattice lambda and its mirror image are rigidly equivalent. So we could transform continuously a lattice to its mirror image. Or briefly, we could say that a lattice lambda maps to itself by suitable reflection. For example, a rectangular lattice is achiral because it's mirror symmetric. If not, so there are lattices that are not mirror symmetric, then we call them chiral. And here it's important to state exactly a criterion of chirality. So a lattice generated by superbase B is achiral if and only if you have one of two possible cases. So root form of this lattice includes zero, and this zero should be, of course, the first number, the lowest. And in that case, it is simply a rectangular lattice. So for two rectangular vectors, of course, one scalar product is zero. Or the second case, the root form has might not have a zero, but it should have two equal root products. So there are three products in total, and two of them should be equal. And in this case, the Voronoi domain is it could be a square, which is again a partial case of the previous one, or a hexagon whose symmetry group is D2. And these two hexagons are drawn in the pictures. So they have, so this group D2 is a group of a symmetry of a rectangle, if I remember correctly. So we have two extra reflections. So horizontal and vertical reflections are included. So in this case, the blue cell here is actually not a primitive cell. It's a sort of non-primitive cell, but for a so-called centered rectangular lattice. Any questions so far? Is everything clear up to this point?
So, I mean, I just want to, about the terminology, I'm a bit mixed up,
please.
Because you speak about two-dimensional space and
two-dimensional lattices.
And you speak about reflection, so it should be kind of reflection line, I would say.
Yes, by reflection, I mean a reflection in a line. You mean a reflection in a point? Can it be confusing with a central symmetry?
Well, I mean, if you say reflection, so to say, you consider reflection with respect to a plane, but you don't have these symmetries here because you're in the two-dimensional space.
Exactly. So today I talk only about two dimensions, and all our reflections are with respect to lines. Mm-hmm. Right. Mm-hmm. And when we have reflection with respect to a point, I usually call it central symmetry. Yeah, to distinguish. Thank you, Moise.
But in two-dimensional space, I mean, do you have such a reflection with respect to a point?
Central symmetry. Okay, let me return. Yes. So this is when we map a vector v to minus v. So every vector is mapped to its opposite. Or you may call it a rotation through angle pi, 180 degrees. So it's so I learned it in school as a central symmetry operation, but some people call it a reflection with respect to a point. As a center of symmetry. Okay. Now, so the first important result. All obtuse superbases of a two-dimensional lattice are isometric. And an extra addition for chiral lattices. So if you have a generic lattice, so not rectangular, not mirror symmetric, then it also has obtuse superbases, and all of them are related not only by isometry, but by orientation preserving isometry. For example, so this central symmetry we have just discussed with Moise is an example of flat rigid motion, because we could rotate by 180 degrees. So these two superbases are related by an orientation preserving isometry in this case. So what are the consequences? The consequences are the following. If two lattices are isometric, then any of the superbases, BB dash, are also isometric. Then the root forms should coincide. So we have discussed this previously. So if we permute, if you reload the vectors, the root forms are the same. And if, of course, we map B to B dash, preserving all indices, so preserving the order, then scalar products or lengths are preserved. So the root forms now, the root form now becomes an invariant of a lattice. But there were several previous steps to make this conclusion, so it is a non-trivial conclusion here. But the root form becomes an isometry invariant. Invariant up to isometry. Any questions so far? So I haven't discussed the proof of this theorem, although it is important, but the proof is briefly illustrated by this picture. We have either a rectangular Voronoi domain or a centrally symmetric hexagon. So it is easy to check that we have only, these superbases in front of us, nothing more. So for two dimensions, it's simple. In three dimensions, it will be much harder. Okay. So now back to chiral lattices. So when we have a chiral lattice, then we need something extra. We need a sign of this lattice to distinguish chiral lattice from its mirror image. So the definition. So this is a bit more involved. So fix an ordered superbase and initially define, well, let's call it subscript S of B as plus one if the order of these vectors around the origin is counterclockwise. So V0, V1, V2, for example, in the left picture here, V0, V1, V2, counterclockwise. So S of B is plus one. But this S of B depends, as you quickly realize, depends on the order. So if you write these vectors in a different order, then S of B will be minus one. So it's not a lattice invariant, but we can make it a lattice invariant as follows. So remember that starting from an ordered superbase, we could get three numbers, but not necessarily in increasing order. So we put them in increasing order by applying a permutation. And I should highlight this is simply a permutation of indices 0, 1, 2. So we simply swap or permute some vectors to put these three root products. So square roots of negative scalar products in increasing order. And we simply multiply this initial sign S of B by the sign with permutation. So if it is a transposition, then sign of transposition is minus one. If it is a cyclic permutation of three indices, it's plus one. And this resulting product, we call it sine of B, and it is an invariant of a lattice up to orientation preserving isometry. So this is a separate lemma, and that's how we add an extra sign. So let me illustrate the difference. So we have this lattice on the left and its mirror image on the right. So for the lattice on the left, I think everything is straightforward. If you write down all scalar products, all root products, so you see V1, V2, scalar product is minus three. So co-norm is three, root product is root three, the first number as expected. Then 0, 1. So let's product of 0, 1, you see is minus six. So co-norm is six, root product is root six in the second place. And similarly, we get root seven. So in increasing order already, so nothing to permute, and the sign is plus. So this is simply because our initial vectors are ordered counterclockwise. Now for the mirror image. So if you choose this basis, but the result is independent of a choice. If you choose U0, U1, U2 as here, then the initial order is counterclockwise. So that S of B dash is plus one. But if you start writing down co-norms, so scalar products, what we see, U1, E2 is minus six, so co-norm is six, and root product is root six, right? So this root six, it comes on the first place, that's why it should be swapped with something else. And indeed, if you take U0, U1, so this scalar product is minus three, co-norm three, root product three. So that's why we should swap root three and root six to put one in increasing order. And this swap changes S of B from minus one to that final sign minus for the lattice, right? So these two mirror images, if you look simply at order at root forms, the root forms are identical, but they differ by a sign, which is a well-defined invariant up to orientation preserving isometry. So we add this sign, well, simply as a subscript here, and call it the oriented root form with the extra sign. Any questions on this?
I'm sorry to interfere, but I'm a bit mixed up with the terminology that you use. So when you speak chiral or ichiral lattice, you mean really lattice, or you mean the basis that you have chosen for the description of that lattice?
Lattice. So I mean a lattice. So the definition, let me see, the definition is here. So lattice is a chiral if it is rigidly equivalent to the mirror image. But some lattices are not a chiral, they are chiral. So this is an example of a chiral lattice. So one lattice, it's mirror image, and these two lattices are not rigidly equivalent. So we cannot make them identical by continuous motion. So they are made identical only by reflection, but not by continuous motion, not by rigid motion.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so thank you. I mean, I'm just trying to mm-hmm. make the correspondence with the crystallographic classification of lattices, and I'm really a bit lost in what you are saying.
Sorry. Okay. So when I advertise the talk, we'll abstract. So Massimo Nispolo quickly replied to me about oblique lattices. So in the crystallography language, two-dimensional chiral lattice is oblique. Is it a standard terminology? Oblique. Okay, so I'll show later. So later, hopefully, it will be a bit clearer.
Yeah, but I mean, that means that you can have your chiral and a chiral only for the oblique lattices?
No. Mm.
For the hexagonal or for the tetragonal or for the rectangular lattices, I mean, the symmetry of the lattice is contains reflection. So I'm really wondering what to make the connection between the two classifications.
Okay. So square lattices a chiral, hexagonal lattice a chiral, any rectangular lattice is a chiral. So with a at the beginning, center at rectangular lattice a chiral, any other lattice is oblique and chiral.
Thank you.
Okay, yeah, you will see pictures with these words in a few slides. Okay, so let me, now, so we have proved the invariance. Now we should, we are proving completeness. So how to go back from an invariant to a lattice. So for any lattice, an obtuse superbase of this lattice can be reconstructed from its root form up to isometry, or if you'd like to preserve orientation, you should use also the sign of a lattice, so we take the oriented root form. And the idea of this reconstruction is very simple. So we have three numbers, R1, R12, R01, R02. So with three root products, from them we could easily find conorms and one norm. So we can find lengths of vectors, for example, V1, V2, and the angle between these vectors from the scalar product. Then we put V1 simply along the positive x-axis, and we know the angle. So we could go counterclockwise or clockwise. So if you don't care about orientation, it doesn't matter. These two lattices are mirror reflections. But if we care about orientation, we should use the sign with extra sign to decide to go clockwise, counterclockwise or clockwise. That's a brief outline how to construct a basis from three numbers plus an additional sign if needed. And altogether, now we have a bijection between, briefly, lattices and root forms. And more exactly, two lattices are isometric if and only if the root forms coincide simply as triples of numbers, as ordered triples. If we would like to say what lattices are isometric by an orientation preserving isometry, then we need the coincidence of the equality between oriented root forms. So it means root forms and also signs should be the same. So this theorem is actually a corollary of all previous steps. So I might hope it might be even already at least understandable to you. But all isometric classes of lattices bijectively correspond to all root forms, triples of numbers, ordered triples. And the next step is to visualize how these root forms, where they live, how the space of root forms looks, and what metrics we can define on these root forms and on lattices. Okay, so root forms, so triples of ordered numbers. Triples of ordered numbers, only one of them can be zero, because if you have two zeros, then one norm is also zero, which is impossible. That's why only one root product is zero. And this triple, it lives in a cone, which is roughly 1/6 of the positive octant. So we have three numbers, three coordinate axes, so marked by R12, R01, R02. So positive octant in the three-dimensional space, right? So these extra inequalities between them, they cut a triangular cone. So for example, this diagonal or bisector line in the positive octant when all three numbers are equal. When all three numbers are equal, such root forms, they represent all hexagonal lattices. So for any hexagonal lattice, there is a point here on that diagonal line, the bisector in the octant, which is now on the boundary of the cone. the diagonal line on the horizontal plane when these two, when R12 is zero, and these two root products are equal. So this line represents all square lattices. So they can be small or large. So that's why we have a line of square lattices here. So that small square indicates square lattices, small triangle. Well, they're called usually hexagonal, but you could also call them well, triangular lattices. And this coordinate axis is actually excluded from the cone, but that's the only exception. And everything inside, so any triple inside corresponds to a lattice, so we can reconstruct a lattice. Right, so this three-dimensional picture is a bit complicated to imagine. That's why we will project it to a simpler quotient triangle. So we cut our octant and our triangular cone by the plane. The sum of three root products equals one. So that's the plane cutting our cone. And this is the intersection. So this yellow triangle is the intersection of our triangular cone with this plane. Okay, and after that, we project the whole triangular cone from the origin to this yellow triangle. So by projection, I mean so simply dividing every coordinate by the sum of three root products. Okay, so this sum is not zero because well, the origin is excluded as the whole coordinate axis R0 tip. Right, so I draw this this section simply flat, and and this projected coordinates are now have bars above, so we have divided by the sum of coordinates. So all hexagonal lattices project into that vertex. This vertex represents all square lattices, and this vertex is excluded because it well you will see it corresponds to unit cells which are very long. Simply, so the infinite excluded case. On the flat projected triangle, it's convenient to choose two coordinates instead of three, and we have chosen x and y here expressed in terms of this projected root products. So x, for example, varies from zero to 1/2, because it's 1/2 of this difference, not negative difference. And y is simply the smallest root product, projected root product. So since it is the smallest, it's between 0 and 1/3. Any questions on these pictures? Okay, then let me show maybe the language closer to crystallography. So on the flat triangle, so we call it quotient triangle. Instead of three numbers, we now have only two numbers, two coordinates, and we call this a form projected form because indeed we projected it. So two numbers, x and y, and actually this projected form is also useful because it classifies lattices up to similarity. You might remember at the very beginning, I defined the similarity equivalence as isometry composed of uniform scaling. So that's exactly what is preserved here, because under projection, we collapse all similar lattices into one class, and with projected forms classify lattices up to similarity. So I guess this is probably the easiest and most important picture on the left from the whole talk. Because this is a map. This is a map of two-dimensional lattices. Yes, not a cone, but projected into this quotient triangle. So the diagonal of the octant projects to that top vertex. So it represents all hexagonal lattices. All hexagonal lattices correspond to this vertex. All square lattices correspond to that vertex. All rectangular lattices from the horizontal sector, horizontal boundary of our cone, they live here on this horizontal edge? Question. Okay, yes. So yes, Nikolai, I'll send you the PDF, of course, no problem. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Right. So rectangular lattices, because root product, one scalar product is zero. So this zero corresponds to the horizontal edge. Now, the vertical edge and the hypotenuse, they correspond to centered rectangular Bravais types. So centered rectangular lattices. So two of them. So we go from the square vertically to the hexagonal lattice. You see, we make that square a bit more elongated in the vertical direction. And then you see we get a hexagon as our Voronoi domain. And then we go along the hypotenuse, and our non-primitive cell becomes thinner, 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 and this is the infinite case, this vertex is excluded. Okay, so all centered rectangular lattices lay live along these two edges. Right, so that's how a chiral lattices look. So all a chiral lattices are along the boundary of that quotient triangle. So they are all mirror symmetric. So symmetric, I mean, rigidly equivalent to like mirror images. But any lattice inside, so this is the most general class, oblique lattices. So like a chiral, not rigidly equivalent to mirror images. Okay, so that's why to represent lattices up to orientation preserving isometry, yeah, we need an extra sign, so our space doubles, so it becomes twice larger. So initially we do it, of course, with the triangular cone, so we have one triangular cone, another triangular cone, and we should glue these two cones along the boundaries together. Well, it's hard to visualize in a three-dimensional space, but hopefully in two dimensions it's easier. So after projection, after we consider an extra equivalence up to similarity, up to uniform scaling, then we have one triangle and simply another triangle, but these two triangles should be glued. So I glue the vertical sides, but of course we should identify all points on the horizontal sides and also on these two hypotenuses. So this point is identified with this point, that point with this point, so they're all glued together. So topologically, it will be actually a sphere with one vertex excluded, so corresponding to that pair. Okay, Mois, so how I clarified classes, Bravais classes in the crystallography language?
No, I'm just trying to find this correspondence, I mean, that you have. So what you're saying is simply that the oblique lattices, I'm still thinking on this terminology. You say chiral because the inherent symmetry is just the twofold rotation. And there is.
Yeah, twofold rotation. All, yeah, right. Yes, through 180 all, degrees.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, all the rest, of course, have higher symmetry as 2mm, 4mm, 6mm. And so obviously they are chiral because this type of symmetry is inherent for them.
Yeah, absolutely correct. Absolutely correct. So generic lattice in the two-dimensional case here in the middle of this triangle, they have only the simply symmetry two-fold rotation. Yes, another name for a central symmetry. Yes. Okay, any more questions? Yeah, I think I need to move, otherwise we will not see metrics. Oh, metrics, right, so on the next slide. So now we have understood completely how root forms, so where our invariants live. And now it's actually rather easy to define metrics, at least for generic isometries. So actually we could take any metric on the three-dimensional space and the result get a metric on lattices. So we simply measure distance between these root forms in the triangular cone. So we could take the Euclidean distance, and yes, there is a, so we can see the Minkowski norms. So with the parameter Q, so Q equals 2 corresponds to the Euclidean distance. the simplest computations are for the L infinity distance. And when we use this underlying distance LQ on root forms, so on triples of numbers, when we add this index subscript Q to the root metric. So why is it a metric? All axioms follow from the axioms from of a metric D. For example, the first axiom. The first axiom is most important. So if this metric equals zero, what does it mean? It means that D is zero, and by the first axiom for D, these two objects should coincide. So the root forms coincide. And in that case, we have already proved that lattices are isometric. So that's why the classification theorem here well, simply proves the first axiom of the metric. Okay, so basically there are many metrics on lattices and they can be easily computed, as they see. Yes, let's do some computations. So square lattices and hexagonal lattices. So square lattice lambda form. I choose yeah, the simplest representation. So 0, 1, 1. So it comes from the standard basis 1, 0, 0, 1. Lambda 6 is a hexagonal lattice. And I choose the root form in the simplest form 1, 1, 1. It doesn't correspond to the interpoint distance 1, but it doesn't matter. So let's consider this example, 1, 1, 1 for simplicity. Then what do we have? We have very projected forms. So 0, 0 is the projected form for square lattice, 0, 1, third for the hexagonal lattice. And the distances are very simple to compute. So square and hexagonal lattice for any parameter Q in the Minkowski norm have distance 1 in between root forms and distance 1/3, so 1/3 plus 1/3 between the projected forms. Any questions? Okay, yeah, there will be more examples as you can guess. But before I compute more metrics, so let me introduce an interesting quantitative measure of chirality. So previously we talked only about objects whether like chiral or achiral. So whether a lattice is isometric to its, so rigidly equivalent to its mirror image or not. But here we actually measure this chirality. So it's not a now true-false property, not a binary property, but a continuous property. So the root chirality is the minimum distance to the closest achiral lattice. So geometrically, yes, so formally it's defined on a cone, but remember this cone is projected to the quotient triangle and root formally it will be called projected chirality. It's simply the distance to the closest boundary of this triangle. So how far away we are from a lattice with a high symmetry. So that's the informal meaning of chirality measure here. So distance to your closest achiral lattice, so to the closest boundary. Well, you have noticed that the definition involves minimization. So all previous formulae were absolutely explicit, but this minimization might seem non-trivial. Nonetheless, for the case at least Q equal infinity, and I'm sure for the Euclidean distance as well, it can be computed explicitly. So it's simply a minimization between three numbers. Well, why three numbers? Because we have three edges of a triangle. So of course we should choose the minimum distance of these three. And the distances can be computed explicitly. So it's rather simple. For example, R12, so why is it here? Because we compare this root form with the root form with zero in the first place. So 0, R01, R02. So and the L infinity distance between them will be exactly that first element. Okay. And then there are two more boundary cases given these differences. So this is defined in terms of root forms. And similarly, chirality, slightly different chirality PC can be defined in terms of coordinates on that quotient triangle. theory. Questions?
So that means that, in fact, your measure, this chirality measure, is only for the oblique lattices.
Well, for all. So for chiral lattices, not oblique, it's zero.
But for example, mm-hmm. can you measure from the rectangular to the square lattice?
No, no, it's the minimum. If we substitute here rectangular lattice, then the result will be minimized for the same rectangular lattice. So the minimum will give the zero value. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you're absolutely right. So for this, for lattices on the boundary, chirality is zero. And this is another criterion of chirality. A lattice is a chiral if and only if its root chirality is exactly zero, or equivalently projected chirality is zero. But if it is not zero, the lattice is somewhere inside.
Okay, so do you have oblique lattices also?
Oblique lattices, yes. For oblique lattices, it's strictly positive. Mm-hmm. So it's one number. So it's for a lattice, so it's a scalar function on the space of lattices. And for a metric, we substitute two lattices, but for chirality, it's a measure for a single lattice. Okay, so depending only on lambda. Okay. yeah, examples. So more examples. So here I have picked some lattices in this quotient triangle. And this was actually a great example of inverse design. So I haven't chosen bases. No, I picked points in this configuration space of lattices. So I picked, for example, so what to choose. So this one, let me discuss lambda zero and lambda naught. So I have, so why this? So this lattice actually has the maximum projected chirality, whose value is 1/10. All other lattices have smaller chiralities, so yeah, it can be easily proved. So this lambda zero, so lambda zero plus, and its mirror image lambda zero minus. But root forms way here are given without signs for simplicity. So I have picked this number. From this number, I have reconstructed the projection of a root form. Well, so 1/10. So this is y, the smallest value. And then the sum of these three numbers should be one, and the difference is again one tenth difference divided by two. So that's how we get this triple of numbers, and then we simply multiply it by 20 to get integers, right? So now I have a root form, and if you wish, yes, we could construct a basis from that, but I started actually from that pair to get this lattice, so not from these numbers. These numbers look rather arbitrary, but numbers in this row were much more natural, so I simply picked points in the triangle. For example, so 1/10 here is the maximum projected chirality, so the maximum distance, yeah, I should add subscript and infinity, so based on the Minkowski-L infinity norm. Okay, but all other chiralities are smaller, and the square lattice, yes, has chirality zero, as expected. So all these were two examples, but this is a plot from real lattices. So in the Cambridge structural database contains, yes, it doesn't contain two-dimensional lattices, it contains only three-dimensional structures, but it contains many. So this big number, nearly 400,000 three-dimensional monoclinic lattices. Three-dimensional monoclinic lattices, a general two-dimensional lattice with an orthogonal basis vector. So it's very natural to take that monoclinic lattice and projected to two dimensions and get a generic two dimensional lattice as a result. So extracted from monoclinic crystals. Okay, so this is a plot. So the quotient triangle filled by real lattices from the Cambridge structural database. And as you see, we don't have many lattices near the horizontal side and also around with extreme vertex, of course, because this extreme vertex corresponds to very narrow cells, so very long cells. And also anything close to the horizontal side means that our unit cells are small, but distances between atoms cannot be very small. That's why there are wide gaps. But apart from that, apart from these natural restrictions, everything else you see is possible. So yes, so remember all say highly symmetric lattices are on the boundary, but almost the whole triangle is filled. So everything here is oblique or chiral. So we're inside the triangle. So the space is continuous in real life. So
I'm sorry, but just think monoclinics obviously have excluded the high symmetrical lattices, no? I mean, this tetragonal, hexagonal, or rectangle. Right. Yeah? So it's excluded from your considerations.
No. All cubical lattices, for example,
No, but you say monoclinics. I mean, it's monoclinic. And this is just the plane that is perpendicular to the monoclinic axis.
No, it's projection. It's plane perpendicular. You are right, but we project three-dimensional monoclinic lattices to two dimensions. Yes.
That means what you're considering are just oblique lattices in the plane. So you're not considering tetragonal, hexagonal, or rectangular lattices.
A good question. I think I should ask actually Matt, who did this experiment. Matt, could you clarify? Are these indeed all oblique, or did you include cubical, hexagonal?
No, we did. So cubical and hexagonal were removed partially because you could include them, but what you would get, since this is a density plot, is an extremely dark line along all of the axes, and you wouldn't be able to see anything inside because you just get tens of thousands of things occupying effectively the axes.
Matt, it can make sense to produce one more plots showing this distribution, for example, along the vertical line, along the...
Yes, I think we do have some distribution of, I think we have some distribution somewhere of square, effectively square and cubic.
So we will do more. Yes.
Lots. I should be able to make that. I mean, there's all sorts of other things that we can do when I catch up with this. One imagines plots of chirality among different groups and the like. So
yes, yes, Moise, you're absolutely right. So far, we have on this plot you see only oblique lattices produced from monoclinics, but it's a big number nonetheless. It's about 1/3 of the whole Cambridge structural database.
No, thank you. I just want to understand, let's say, your results. I'm sure. Not subjecting.
Sure. Okay. Right. So let me. So what of time? 2 minutes. Okay. So let me quickly finish with continuity. So to formally state continuity, we need also metric on basis, so super basis. So there is one simple metric, L infinity, when we try to match our super basis with a most optimal rotation. This is a theoretical distance, so it can be only approximated. So of course it is discontinuous if you change your basis, but if this distance is small, so it means that our bases are indeed very similar. And in that case, it makes sense to ask whether root forms are similar or not, so have close values. And this is the formal result plan. So if you have two bases whose corresponding vectors differ slightly, so this is simply the distance of the difference, the length of the difference, so not more than delta, then we have an upper bound for the root metric between the corresponding lattices in terms of delta and for the projected metric as well. So this is so-called Lipschitz continuity. So in a very strict sense, for the inverse map, so going from root forms to bases, it's a bit more complicated, but we can still prove continuity. So for example, if you have lattices with a very small distance, so not more than delta, And if this delta goes to zero, then we can find basis of these lattices so that the L infinity distance between them also tends to zero. So this is a continuity in the opposite direction. And let me finish with summary slide, so summarizing the whole approach. So our initial problem was to understand the space, lattice isometry space of classes of lattices considered up to isometry. The previous approach was to take a basis, a reduced basis, so nice basis, but all these bases are unfortunately discontinuous under perturbations. That's why we developed the new results in the top right part of this picture. So this reduction was known before to obtuse superbases, but what is new is the construction of this invariant root form. So the classification theorem, which is a bijection between these two spaces, and also continuity, but this bijection is continuous in both directions. Right, the very early version of the paper is on archive, but we have an updated version here linked on my web page. If you have any questions, please ask. So let me now stop recording and and we will have a discussion if you have time, of course.